Hello everyone and welcome to my latest Doctor Who review, where today I review The Keeper of Traken, which is the 114th story of the entire show. It is the penultimate story in season 18, and it is also Tom Baker's penultimate story as the fourth Doctor. Sad. After so long, he only has one more story left, but we'll get to that next time. It is also the introduction of Nyssa. Nyssa, the companion who will be very prominent in Peter Davison's era. So, yeah. And it is also labelled as the first of the Master Trilogy. So, there you go. It's quite a historical story on a number of accounts, isn't it? Right. Okay, the plot of The Keeper of Traken is as follows. The Fourth Doctor and Adric learn from the wizened Keeper of Traken that a great evil has come to his planet in the form of a Melker, a calcified statue. The Keeper of Traken is nearing the end of his reign and seeks the Doctor's help in preventing the evil from taking control of the bioelectronic source that is the keystone of Traken Union's civilization. That's essentially the plot of this story. Well, The Keeper of Traken. This is a very interesting story. It's good. I think it's good. It's way better than Warrior's Gate, so don't worry. It's a story that you can follow. It makes sense. I don't think it's perfect. I don't think this is a masterpiece of a story, but it was pretty good. It was pretty decent, you know. I think this is a great story to bring back the Master. I think the Master reappears in this story. Obviously, the last time we saw the Master was in The Deadly Assassin, with Peter Pratt playing a disfigured version of the Master. And in this particular story, we have an actor called Geoffrey Beevers, who essentially is doing an impersonation of Peter Pratt, and he looks the same. So I think we're meant to assume that he is the same incarnation. He also does the voice of the Melker as well, which is really good. I think he's good. I think the Master's good in this story, although I think he is revealed a little bit too late. I would have actually liked the Master to have done a bit more in the story. He is kind of left until the last act of the story, so yeah, I mean, we hear his voice throughout the story, but I just think it would have been nice for him to appear a bit earlier on, because there's a lot of talking in this story. I think this story is a little bit slow in the pacing. It's a bit brisker than the previous story, don't get me wrong. It moves along quicker than Warrior's Gate. But it does feel kind of tedious at points, and it's like, okay, you know, characters are just standing around talking, and I'd like them to get on with the plot, please. I mean, this is a four-part story, so you can sit through it fine, but it does feel a little bit long in places. I think they could tighten up the pacing at times, but it's nice to see the Master back. And of course, the Master in the end of the story does achieve a new body, which is what he tried to do in The Deadly Assassin, except this time he takes the form of Tremas, who is actually Nyssa's father, I believe. I think he's her father. At the very end of the story, Tremas and the Master kind of join bodies, and then the Master takes on Tremas's body. So yeah, that's an interesting way to end the story, and I look forward to seeing Anthony Ainley going further in story. I mean, of course, no one can ever truly live up to Roger Delgado, but still, I'm not surprised it's been a while since Delgado passed, and I think by this point, they were able to recast the role and take the role further, because it is such an iconic role, and it's unfortunate what happened to Delgado, but, you know, the reality is that he was never going to be the only person to play this part. So I like the ending. I just think the Master could have done a bit more in the story. Speaking of Nyssa, I like Nyssa. Yeah, Sarah Sutton, who plays Nyssa, she's quite gentle, she's quite sweet. We don't know much about her yet, other than, you know, the relationship with her father and whatnot, but she does get involved in the story, and she helps Adric out quite a lot, and her and Adric develop quite a good rapport, so that's good. And I know Nyssa's going to be around for a bit of time in Peter Davison's era, so that's nice. I think Sarah Sutton plays her very well, and I like Nyssa. She's just a very genuine, sweet girl, and, you know, there's not much else to her, really. So I look forward to seeing how they explore her character a bit more. As for Adric, I did complain about Adric in the previous few stories, how he was kind of underutilized. And again, I still think that Matthew Waterhouse is not a particularly great actor. I still stand by my opinion that he's just not very good as Adric. But in this particular story, I actually quite liked Adric. I actually thought Adric was okay, and he got involved with the story. And I mean, I still don't think he has any on-screen chemistry with Tom Baker. I don't think the two of them work well together at all. They do seem very mismatched, and they do seem very disinterested in one another, and that shows in their performances. But in terms of the script and the characters, I do think that Adric is less annoying in this story. He's not going around spouting out how he's a know-it-all in this story. He does get involved in the story, and he doesn't try and overshadow the Doctor as well, which is good. So Matthew Waterhouse, I'd say he gives a better performance. I'm not going to say it was good, but I'll say his performance was better. You know, he was written better in this story as well. So I'll give the story that. And of course, Tom Baker as the Doctor. I mean, he does look quite bored in some of the scenes in this story. He is losing his enthusiasm. I mean, there are some scenes when he's trying, and he does try and bring in some of that old school humour that we love, and his Doctor, but he does look a bit tired in some of the scenes, and you could tell he was going to leave. I think you could see in his face that he didn't want to be there anymore. So we've still got one more story to appreciate Tom Baker, but he does give a good performance in this story. He just looks a bit tired, you know. He looks a bit burned out, but nevertheless, he's still good as the Doctor, and he always will be. The supporting cast, I have to mention Anthony Ainley. Of course, he's going to be playing the Master going forward from the next story onwards. But he plays Tremas here, and he's a very nice character, and I like Tremas, and he's meant to be the one that takes over from the Keeper, who's like this guardian who watches over Traken. I mean, because they're told in the beginning of the story that there's this evil that's coming to Traken and whatnot. So, yeah, it's like a sort of watchful protector role. But obviously, he's married to Cassia, and Cassia wants to be with Tremas and wants to make sure that they are still together. Cassia is also a good character. She gets hypnotized by the Melka, or, well, the Master, quite a bit in this story, and the actress is Sheila Ruskin. Yeah, Sheila Ruskin, who gives a very good performance. I am getting, again, I said this a while ago, I'm sick of all the hypnotism. You know, it's become so mundane now. But I will let it go for this story because I like the way she performed it. I like the way Sheila Ruskin performed it. I just think the hypnotism stuff is getting very old. But it's not going to go away anytime soon, so I'll just have to let it go. Saron, played by John Woodnut, he's also very good. I like Saron. He gives a good performance. Keturah, played by Margot Van De Boer. Yeah, I think she's the elderly woman. She is the elderly woman that features in the story. She's very good. I like her. And Luvic. He's also quite good. So there's a good cast in this story, and I also like the costumes and the set design. The spectacle of this story is great. There is an expensive budget that has been spent on this story, and it really shows on screen, which is really good. I like the final confrontation with the Master and the Doctor. I think there's a lot of great tension there, and it's not obviously as epic as the Deadly Assassin, of course not, but it's nice when the Doctor and the Master reunite, and that's very interesting. And again, as I said, I really love the ending of the story with when Nyssa can't find her father anymore, and her father's body has been overtaken by the Master, and then he flies off in his TARDIS, which is a old grandfather clock, which is good. The music is all right, although there's not much music in this story, not to my memory, really. It doesn't seem to sort of stick out to me very much. But thankfully, unlike the previous story, you can follow this story, and it's not too complicated. The direction by John Black is very good, very tight. It moves along. I say it moves along. There's a couple of pacing issues for me, but generally speaking, it's fun. You know, it's a fun story. I just do think it was a wasted opportunity leaving the Master right to the end. I mean, fair enough, build up to his reveal. But I think halfway through the story, you could have revealed him. To have him in at least the last two parts is good, because I think you know, the Master's such an iconic character. I know what they're trying to do, but to me, it just felt, it was like it wasn't enough. By the time we get to that climax, it's over really quickly, and then it's like, oh, I've not really seen much of Geoffrey Beevers. I've not really seen much of Geoffrey Beevers as the Master. I've not seen him had a chance to really do his thing, but, oh well, it's, never mind. The script by Johnny Byrne is also very good. Again, but I would have liked to have seen the Master sooner. That's my main criticisms. So overall, this is a pretty good story, and I'm not going to say it's the best of the season, but I liked it. I thought it was fun, and it did have a couple of flaws, but nothing really that damages it too much. And yeah, as penultimate stories go, this is the best one so far. I mean, out of the first four Doctors, this is easily the best penultimate Doctor Who story, because with William Hartnell, you had The Smugglers, which was a snooze. You then had The Space Pirates with Patrick Troughton, which was a snooze. And then you had The Monster of Peladon with John Pertwee, which was a snooze. So thankfully, this one isn't as boring as those. But it's not perfect, but I would gladly watch this over any of the other penultimate stories. I mean, actually, the Hartnell and Troughton ones are missing, so I watched the reconstructions when I did my reviews for those. But anyway, that's kind of my thoughts on the Keeper of Traken. So I am going to finish up and rate this story an 8 out of 10. I think it's a good, solid story. I wouldn't say it's anything more than that. It's fun. You know, it's good fun. But there we go, folks. That is my review of The Keeper of Traken. And, yep, stay tuned next time when we review the 42nd and final story for Tom Baker, Logopolis. The 115th story and the very last story in Season 18. But the most important thing being, it is Tom Baker's final story as the Fourth Doctor. Gonna have to get my tissues and jelly babies at the ready. This is gonna be emotional. But anyway, thank you all very much for watching this review, and stay tuned next time when I review Logopolis, the finale to Tom Baker's era. So until next time, see you soon. Bye for now.